thank you, Jacques. I'm not sure I'm up to all of those jobs. It's always a great pleasure to be here in Annecy at the foundation, at the conference center. It's one of the best venues I know of for a conference. I was asked to sort of kick this meeting off with a brief overview of the arboviral threats that we face. And what I'm going to do is talk about some of the viruses that are currently involved and that may be involved in the future, use some of them for case studies and talk about the basic and the changing epidemiology of these viruses, briefly touch on the emergence, the drivers of emergence, and then finish up by talking about some of those other viruses with an emphasis on yellow fever. So we all know that the pandemic infectious diseases are two basic types. They're either respiratory transmitted or vector-borne. And of the vector-borne, the mosquitoes are the most important. And most of these are viruses. There is one bacteria involved, a plague. But all of the other pandemic agents have been viruses in recent years. Arboviruses are a critical component of this group, and don't try to read this slide, but the message it conveys is that you can't go anywhere in the world really without being at risk to one arbovirus or another. And if you look at those, you'll see that they're are some that repeated all over the world. This is just some of the resurgent epidemic viruses that we've seen in the past 20 years or so, and I've highlighted the first three. I'm going to use those as case studies just to illustrate some of the epidemiology that it's involved, and touch very briefly on chikungunya and Zika. So beginning with the West Nile virus, this is a different ecology from the types of viruses that we're normally talking about in urban areas. It's an African virus that its basic cycle involves birds and Culex mosquitoes, and the birds act as amplification hosts. It causes epidemics in humans, in horses, both of which are incidental hosts. They probably don't contribute a lot to transmission, but also epizootics in birds. These viruses in the past weren't known to kill birds, but more recent epidemics have shown that, in fact, that they do kill birds. The virus was first isolated in the West Nile Valley of Kenya in 1937. For the first 60 years that this virus was known to medical sciences, it was not considered to be a major public health problem. It did cause a few epidemics, the green stars in South Africa, in India, Egypt, Israel, and France during that time, but usually no severe disease associated with it at all. That all changed in the mid-1990s when a series of epidemics and epizootics began to occur in the Mediterranean basin. And these epizootics were different in the sense that they were causing severe and fatal disease in both horses and in humans, and then subsequently in birds as well. They never got reported. They simply were ignored by for whatever reason, they're not reported to the But in 1996, an epidemic occurred here in Bucharest, which we in CDC investigated. had a fairly high rate of severe neurologic disease. And in 1999, a major epidemic occurred in Volgograd, Russia. And at about the same time, the virus was introduced into the Western Hemisphere, into New York City. The first year it was there, it was localized in New York and New Jersey, Connecticut area. But it moved, then started to move south in 2000. And by 2001, it had become established in much of the northeastern part of the United States. And in 2002, a major epidemic occurred in the central zone with over 14,000 cases of neurologic disease in horses and 4,000 cases of neurologic disease in humans. And it reached the West Coast that year. Basically, if you look at the bird flyways, this movement fits exactly with the Atlantic Flyway, with the Mississippi Flyway, and the Central Flyway. So this virus just moved, and it's started following the patterns it did in Africa, that moves from Africa to Europe and back. So over the next few years, this is what happened to West Nile. Outbreaks occurring throughout the United States and Canada and Caribbean, Central and South America. The virus has a very broad vector range. There are four species of mosquitoes that transmit the virus in the United States: Culex pipiens in the northern part of the country, Culex quinquefasciatus and Culex nigripalpus in the south, and Culex tarsalis in the western United States. All of these are very effective vectors and transmit it primarily to birds. But pipiens and quinquefasciatus, nigripalpus, and tarsalis all also bite humans. And so we're not sure which mosquito species was playing the major role in transmission to humans. As I mentioned, it has a tremendously wide vector range. It's been isolated in the United States alone from over 63 species of mosquitoes. And these are the main mosquitoes that transmit it to birds. But large numbers of mammal-feeding birds and opportunistic feeders that feed on both mammals and birds. It's also been isolated from about 30 mammalian species in North America. So it's suggesting that this virus could probably set up shop anywhere that it's introduced. So because it has such a broad host and vector range. So that introduces the viruses that belong to the Japanese encephalitis serogroup, and there's a bunch of other viruses that fit into that category. But there's another group that are more important, I think, at least, because they cause urban epidemics in pretty much in whole of the tropical world. Dengue and Zika and yellow fever are all flaviviruses. Chikungunya is an alpha virus. They all have basically the same epidemiology. They all exist in a sylvatic cycle of monkeys and canopy-dwelling mosquitoes in the rainforests of Africa, Asia, or the Americas. At some time in the past, they came out of the forest, brought out by workers into village areas where they caused sporadic and transient epidemics. They'd come out, disappear. As commerce developed and port cities became more urbanized, at some point several hundred years ago, these viruses were brought out and introduced into urban centers where they were transmitted by paradomestic mosquitoes. As the airplane industry developed, they spread throughout the world and established cycles involving humans as amplification hosts and Aedes aegypti mosquitoes as the principal vector. So with this type of transmission cycle, there is really no barrier to the spread of these viruses. Anywhere the mosquito occurs and where people live that has warm weather at least part of the year, they're susceptible to transmission. So this is the principal epidemic vector, Aedes aegypti. It's an African mosquito. It was brought out of Africa in the 1600s, probably maybe even earlier, with the slave trade, and then spread around the world several hundred years ago. So it has a global distribution in the tropics. So it took 200 or 300 years for this this mosquito to spread to over 120 countries. Aedes albopictus is the other principal vector, although it's not as efficient as an epidemic transmission. It's an Asian mosquito that started moving around the world about 30 years ago in the mid-1980s, so relatively recent, but it is much faster. It has established a global distribution in the tropics already. There are other mosquito species that have the potential to transmit in urban or peri-urban habitats, and I've just listed them here, but there are some of them here, but most of them belong to the Stegomyia subgenus of Aedes, and mainly because these are container breeding mosquitoes that can set up shop just about anywhere. So let's use dengue as the case study for this group of virus to show you what has happened in the past 20 or 30 years. If you know your history, dengue was a big problem for both the Allied and the Japanese armies during World War II in the Asia-Pacific region. After the war, there was a quiescent period for about 20 years, sporadic cases, but in the 1970s, dengue began to rear its head and spread in Asia, jumped over to the Americas. In the 80s, this accelerated. In the 80s and the 90s, more acceleration till this is the present known distribution of dengue viruses. You'll note that Africa is pretty bare there. That doesn't mean there are no viruses there. It simply means that the surveillance is poor and we don't really know how much dengue is occurring in those countries. We started virologic surveillance for these viruses in the early 1970s when we developed methods that would allow us to isolate the virus on a regular basis. And in 1970, this is what we knew about the distribution of the four viruses. Only South, the Asian countries had what we call hyperendemicity, that is all four serotypes co-circulating. The American tropics and the African tropics, those countries, most of them were either hypoendemic with a single virus or no virus is circulating at all. What I want to do in the next couple of slides, next series of slides, is to show you what happened, how these viruses spread around the world over a period of about 20, 30 years. And this is just the tip of the iceberg that I'm going to show you. It represents just selected the viruses that actually established the serotype in different geographic areas, but certainly by no means includes all the viruses that spread. But it began in 1971, and surprisingly, with the dengue 2 introduction from the French West Indies into the South Pacific, into Tahiti. It's what I call the French connection, because it's happened several times since. But that was followed by dengue 4 into the South Pacific, dengue 4 into the Americas, or dengue 1 into the South Pacific and the Americas, dengue 4 into China and into the South Pacific, dengue 3 into the South Pacific and China, dengue 2 and dengue 4, new introductions into the Americas, dengue 2 into East Africa, and dengue 3 into East Africa, and finally dengue 3 into the Americas. And pretty much this established the serotypes in these different geographic regions. This is what we ended up with. And the whole of the tropical world now is hyperendemic with multiple virus serotypes co-circulating. And this is why we've seen such dramatic increase in epidemic activity in the past 30, 40 years. You can see where I'm pushing the wrong buttons here, the activity really started here in the 1970s, accelerated in the 80s and 90s, but This resulted then in dramatic geographic spread of both the viruses and the vectors, increased epidemic activity, and hyperendemicity in many of these regions. We saw the same thing. It took dengue 30 years to do this. It took chikungunya about 10 years to do the same spread. It followed right in the path of the dengue viruses, but it only took 10 years to move around the world. This top graph just shows the epidemic curve for chikungunya when it was introduced into the American region in 2014. And we saw the same pattern again with Zika virus, followed in the path of chikungunya and dengue, spread around the world, but it only took 7 years for this virus. So there's a trend here occurring, and it probably associated with the global trends that I'm going to be talking about in just a moment. So basically, the question then is, why have we seen such a dramatic increase in epidemic activity of these primarily flaviviruses, but also some alpha viruses? And all of these reasons that I've listed here, you've seen them many times. They've all contributed, and they're all important, but the point I want to make is that none of them are critical. You could take any one or all of them out of there, and we would still be seeing the emergent epidemic disease. The main factors driving these epidemics are global trends. The main global trend is population growth and urbanization. We now have cities of 10 to 20 million people in just about all tropical developing countries. People move to the cities to work. They live in inadequate housing, lack of good water, sewage, waste management systems, creating ideal ecological conditions for both the mosquito vectors and the viruses to persist and increase in transmission. At the same time, we had changing lifestyles, automobile tires, plastic tins, etc., that make perfect breeding sites for the mosquitoes. So at the same time, in these urban centers, we saw a tremendous increase in mosquito populations. Combine that, every one of these cities have a brand new airport, or at least an airport that is expanding. This shows the global air network up here. Every one of those green lines represents an air route that's flown daily, multiple times daily and weekly, and provides the ideal mechanism to move pathogens around the world. At any time of the day and night, there's tens of thousands of airplanes in the air carrying tens of millions of people. This graph at the bottom shows the annual average number of people flying by airplane somewhere. So you can see this dramatic increase over a period from 1950 through 2010. In 2018, it's estimated that over 3 billion people will get on an airplane and fly somewhere. And many of those people are carrying pathogens. The container shipping industry shown here has been instrumental, critical in moving the mosquito vectors around the world. So modern transportation and globalization is the other major global trend that has influenced this activity. So we have population growth with unprecedented urban growth, which creates ideal conditions for both the mosquitoes and the viruses. You end up with increased transmission. With increased transmission, you have a greater probability of genetic change in the viruses that lead to increased epidemic potential of the viruses. And then you have the jet airplane that moves the viruses around the world, introducing them into permissive areas where Aedes aegypti occurs, where there's no effective mosquito control. And the result is epidemic activity. So the virus, the mosquito, occurs in a belt around the world. There's an estimated 3.6 billion people living in areas infested by this mosquito. So what other viruses are we looking at that could potentially have urban transmission, cause urban epidemics? And this is a graphic that Tom Monath and Scott Weaver and I put together several years ago when Zika emerged. We've listed them as severity on this axis, the probability of occurring on this axis, and you can see this upper right upper quadrant has a bunch of viruses that we feel have the highest potential for emergence and spread. And one of these is Rift Valley Fever. It's a Bunya virus. You'll hear about this, I guess, day after tomorrow, but there is a major epidemic going on in Kenya right now. Rift Valley Fever is very similar to West Nile in the sense that it has a very broad host and vector range, and if it is introduced into an area, the chances are it'll be able to become established and spread. But by far and away, yellow fever is the virus that has the greatest potential for emergence and spread. And so I want to spend the rest of the time talking about yellow fever, because I really do think that we're sitting on a tie bomb. I think this virus has the potential to be the next pandemic, cause the next pandemic. This just shows the current distribution of yellow fever virus. It occurs in sub-Saharan Africa in a sylvatic cycle involving monkeys and mosquitoes, and also in the Amazon basin of the American continent. Yellow fever was effectively controlled in the Americas for over 70 years and in Africa for the better part of 40 or 50 years. In Africa, the French neurotropic vaccine was developed in 1940 and was used very effectively to control epidemic yellow fever in West Africa. In the Americas, it was a combination of Aedes aegypti eradication and vaccination that controlled it. In the 1980s, there were epidemics that occurred in West Africa. The virus sort of calmed down a little bit, but in the last two or three years, we've seen a dramatic increase in urban epidemics in both Africa and the Americas, and that's what has us concerned today. In the Americas, we effectively controlled the virus for the better part of 70 years. That was due to the eradication program. This shows the distribution of Aedes aegypti in 1930 when yellow fever was the scourge of the Americas. A program was initiated by the Pan American Health Organization in 1946 that eliminated Aedes aegypti from all of these countries, eliminated it from 22 countries. By the early 1970s, they hadn't had an epidemic of yellow fever in the American region for nearly 40 or so years, and the powers that be, the policymakers, decided it was a waste of money to continue this program, so they disbanded it. And as soon as they disbanded it, Aedes aegypti began to reinfest the countries where it had been eliminated, and this is the approximate distribution today. The difference is that during the coincident with this reinfestation during the 80s and the 90s, the 2000s, this whole region of South America became urbanized. And today over 75% of the people living in tropical America live in cities. And at the same time, the changing lifestyles have created larger populations than Aedes aegypti than any time. So we're sitting on a very explosive situation. This Brazil is a good example of what has happened to yellow fever in many of the Latin American countries. And this just shows from 1980 to the present time, Brazil actively controlled yellow fever, and before this, from the 1940s. So over 70 years, they controlled the virus. But in the last couple of years, they've had a resurgence and a reemergence of epidemic, epizootic yellow fever, beginning in 2016. This is partially due to expanding distribution of Aedes aegypti in the country. This shows the distribution in 1995 through 2017. The whole of the country now is pretty well infested with Aedes aegypti. The virus is actually limited, has been limited in the Amazon basin here. This is the enzootic area. This red area represents the edge area, the fringe area between the forest and the urban areas, and where epizootic transmission occurred. The epizootic area has actually moved now clear to the East Coast in a period of 20 years. Only three states up here in the Northeast are considered by the Brazilian Ministry of Health as free of yellow fever now. This just shows the current epidemic that's going on. It began in 2016, it continued in 2017. I don't know whether you can see it or not, but there are two bars on this graph. One is a light pink and the other one is dark red. And the light pink represents the 2016-17 outbreak. Dark red represents the current 2018 epidemic. And you can see that the current epidemic is considerably larger than the one that occurred last year. The Brazilian authorities consider that this is an epizootic. It's not transmitted by Aedes aegypti. They say there's no evidence of Aedes aegypti transmission. Part of the evidence for this is shown here. This just shows the distribution of primate cases of yellow fever, confirmed primate cases, and confirmed human cases, and the distribution is almost identical. However, this is a highly urban area, and it's hard to believe that Aedes aegypti didn't feed on some of those people. But the point is there's no evidence that Aedes aegypti is transmitting this epidemic. What is important is that in 2018, there have been more cases of yellow fever exported from Brazil than in the past 20 years put together. And most of those cases, there's five of them introduced to Europe, another five to other parts of mainly Peru of South America, and one to the United States. There may have been others since I made this slide, but a tremendous increase in people moving the virus out of Brazil into other areas. Africa has also had increased epidemic activity in the last couple of years. It began with an epidemic in Angola in 2016, which moved into the Democratic Republic of Congo. This year, there's been epidemic activity in Nigeria and in Uganda. The Angola epidemic was the largest. Over several months, it moved throughout the country. It began in the capital city of Luanda and then moved throughout the country and then into the Democratic Republic of the Congo. But the important thing here is that during the first 3 months of 2016, 11 confirmed cases of yellow fever were imported into China. And this is the first time in the history that yellow fever has been imported into Asia, documented. So that should be a wake-up call to us as well. To top that off, this is a figure from a paper that was just published last month in the Bulletin of the World Health Organization. Simon Hay and his group looked at the enforcement of the international health regulations that requires that anyone visiting yellow fever endemic area should have proof of vaccination if they go to other countries. And I know you can't read this, but the take-home message is that in 2016, they estimate that over 60 million people either traveled to or from a yellow fever endemic area and to areas that were permissive for yellow fever transmission. And they then followed this up by looking at the international health regulations and where they're enforced. These bars, the red and the yellow bars, represent the population in cities of countries that either require proof of vaccination or do not require proof of vaccination. The red bars are from countries that don't require proof of vaccination, even if you visit a yellow fever endemic area. The yellow bars represent cities in countries that do require proof of vaccination, but if you've traveled much in Asia, from Latin America or from Africa, you know that the IHR is not enforced on a regular basis. So the areas, both the American tropics and Asia, are, I think, at high risk for urban transmission of yellow fever. And just to show this again, the highest numbers in the history are being exported from Brazil and from Africa into countries around the world. So that puts us at really high risk. To illustrate what could happen, I went to the OAG and asked it, where can I go in 24 to 48 hours from Santa Cruz, Bolivia? And anywhere in the world, basically. The area that we're really concerned about is this area out here in the Asia-Pacific region. There are approximately 2 billion people that live in areas that are infested by Aedes aegypti. So if yellow fever breaks out and starts to move in travelers around the world, it'll create a international public health emergency that'll make SARS pale by comparison, I think. So what are the risk factors that we're talking about? Let me just summarize them here again for you. We have unprecedented urban growth in the past 50 years. Crowded tropical urban centers provide ideal ecological conditions to maintain the viruses and the vectors. Globalization provides the ideal mechanism to move these viruses around the world. Aedes aegypti and albopictus both have a global distribution in the tropics. The at-risk susceptible population is over half of the world's population, 3.6 billion people. There's low herd immunity in all of these populations that we're talking about. There's tens of millions of travelers that visit yellow fever areas every year. Many of them do not have immunization vaccine, and the international health regulations, proof of vaccination is not enforced in a lot of countries. Encroachment by humans, i.e. ecotourism, has put many more people at risk of encroaching on the sylvatic cycle, and that many of the cases in Brazil were associated with that type of tourism. Vector control has been unsuccessful in preventing dengue, Zika, chikungunya, so it's unlikely that it would have any impact on a yellow fever epidemic. And unfortunately, the vaccine, which is a very good vaccine, the best live virus vaccine we have, is either unavailable or inadequate supply. So a lot of risk factors that put us at the highest risk, I think, in over 70 years for urban transmission of yellow fever. So the burning question is, if that's the case, why haven't we seen yellow fever yet? You would expect that we may have seen epidemics. And of course, we don't know the answer to that. It's more speculation. There are a bunch of hypotheses. I list them here. I don't have time to go through them, but if you want to talk to me after the talk, I'd be happy to discuss them. But there are three main reasons, I think, why we haven't seen epidemic yellow fever yet. We have seen epidemic yellow fever. It hasn't broken out and spread. And those three reasons are that there probably are barriers of yellow fever immunity due to vaccination and natural infection in endemic countries. There's the whole issue of cross-protective flavivirus immunity that we don't fully understand. There's some old monkey data that where people infected monkeys with that had dengue antibody that suggests that dengue antibody actually doesn't protect against yellow fever infection, but it downregulates clinical illness and downregulates viremia, which would make it more difficult to transmit. And but the reason I really think the main reason is that yellow fever has been relegated to a monkey, feral mosquito monkey cycle for 70 plus years. And it has not yet regained an efficient transmission cycle in Aedes aegypti in humans. And once that happens, then I would expect the virus to take off. So in conclusion, the risk of epidemic arboviral diseases, I think, is the highest in history. Vaccines are unavailable or in a short supply. Vector control has been ineffective in preventing epidemics. I think we can expect to see more viruses emerging. What they'll be, we don't know. But we think that control is possible if we use the right approach and have the right tools. And along that line, we have created a new organization called the Global Dengue and Aedes Transmitted Diseases Consortium. It's a consortium of partners, international agencies here. It's administratively housed in the International Vaccine Institute in Seoul, Korea. We work closely with WHO in our program. But basically what this organization is a think tank type of organization. What we do is bring together experts that deal with a specific topic. Then come out with recommendations on that particular topic. In terms of prevention and control, we recommend a strategy of integration and synergy, three components, using vector control, vaccination, and surveillance, combined with good clinical management, therapeutics, and community engagement. And basically go into an area, look at the ecology, look at the culture, look at the economics, the epidemiology, and work with the Ministry of Health to develop a program that is best suited for that particular ecological situation. So with that, thank you very much.